Son and Son. There may be qualitatively equal because they're both the same kind of entity. But they're not exactly the same. So Father is still first before the Son. But this is very interesting because today in modern Christianity, many times they say that Jesus is God. I don't know, it's some kind of a impersonalism. Jesus says, I'm the Son. He says, I'm like unto the Father. Son is like the Father. Who are you with him? Any son or daughter is like their father or mother. So, he's like his father. But he never said, I am the Father. But when you say he's God, God is the Father. Jesus is God. That means you're trying to say he's the Father. So there's be some kind of resonance. Some speculation that's entered into their theology. And they use some words that I am the Word. Since the Word is God, so I'm God. He's a spiritual master, and a spiritual master represents the scriptures. And the scriptures are not different from Krishna, but that doesn't mean he's the Father. It means he's the personified teachings of the Father, something like that. So I mean, it's interesting. Here Prabhupada says so clearly, I mean, it completely goes against this present concept they have. The sons and the fathers are qualitatively equal, but the father is never the son, nor is the son ever the father. What's interesting also is that the father is—it's not a big deal to want to be the father because we can only be what we are. But being God. I mean, he's God, we can't imagine what it's like, he knows everything. So there's no surprises for him. But being a devotee of the Lord, that also has its advantages. Prabhupada was explaining that we're the server God, and he's the served God. There are all different aspects of God, but ultimately everything is God, in the sense that everything is an expansion or energy of the Lord. But he's the original personality of Godhead, and we are the servants of him. So we are the servant parts and parcels, both part of Godhead, part of the whole absolute truth, part of the whole God reality. But our function is to serve the Lord. Now, when we serve the Lord, we get fully happy. If he's even a little bit pleased with us, and gives us a little bit of mercy, for us it's like a tsunami. I was just in Sri Lanka and Chennai and Tamil Nadu, and we're feeding the people there. A lot of help came from Europe, America, and different places. And so a little wave in the ocean, when it gets to the shore, it becomes a gigantic tidal wave, or tsunami. Sucks up all the water from the shore. Comes in. I was talking to some of the ladies who were feeding the sadhu. They're still really dramatic. They're really freaked out because they can't sleep. They don't have a house anymore, but they sleep away from the beach. And they're building some temporary houses on the beach, but they're afraid to sleep there because it was so traumatic. All of a sudden, you wake up and find yourself in a tumult and a strange world. So they're not feeling secure anymore to be right next to the ocean. Before it was a problem for them to use. Take a while to get over the trauma. But So Krishna, he's a little bit pleased with us. For us, it becomes like a tsunami. It becomes like a huge wave of ecstasy. And that's why, the devotees of the Lord, they appear to be with more happiness than the Lord. Because being the Lord, it's pretty good hard to make an impression on him. But he gets pleased easily. He's always pleased. It's very easy. His nature is to be always pleased. It's only Radharani who can make a super great impression on him. He gets pleased with the other services of the devotees. But the devotees, when they serve the Lord, they actually get so happy. And this, seeing the devotees happiness makes the Lord happy. And he wants to serve the devotees. And then when the devotees are happy, the Lord's happy, they get happier. And when they get happier, the Lord gets happier. It's like this keeps on increasing. But somehow, in my vision, Krishna sees that the devotees seem to be happier than he is. So he wanted to figure out why is it that the devotees, what is it that they're experiencing? It's one of the devotees with whom this was the past time mentioned in the Chaitanya Mangal. That in the Dvapara Yuga,
Krishna went from Satyabhama's
palace to Rukmini's palace. Rukmini, when she found that Krishna was going to come to the palace, she got it all prepared, everything clean, brought kirtan party, brought brahmanas and chant mantras, brought music bands, decorated the door with sugar canes, pots, and cool water pots. In ancient Vedic culture, when you want to have a decoration to welcome someone, makes things auspicious, you put full water pots and the full banana trees with the fruits hanging. And sugar canes, pots. And the whole grains, sprouts, sprouted grains, things like that. Sort of natural things, things which are auspicious, natural. I mean, like here in the West, we tend to put all kinds of aluminum tinsels, which are and all kinds of the decorations you make to show some kind of auspicious occasion, like Christmas or something. It's all like plastic. When you have a party, you put those same kind of stuff. Paper is probably inspired by paper. But the Vedic tradition is they put like leaves from mango tree, ampata, and they also put the leaves from coconut. In South India, they make coconut tree leaves for the plates in the mouth. It's all natural things. So Rukmini, she decorated her house with all these natural things, no tinsel, no Christmas lights. It was very beautiful and it was very auspicious. So when Krishna came, pot shells, music, mantras. And so when someone very special comes, like you did, you had a kirtan and some flowers. I was embarrassed at the moment. I couldn't reciprocate. I said, Krishna, he's perfectly able to reciprocate. He smiles at everybody. He touches the elder's feet and he hugs the embraces his equals and blesses his juniors. He smiles at everybody just appropriately. He does everything perfectly. When he's received, we read the reception in the first canto of him coming to Dwarka.
and the pain can come.
It shows us how Christians are expert to reciprocate with their health. But let me thank you as a very humble representative of Srila Prabhupada for your wonderful reception. And let me apologize for being late. Right. Came and disappeared. I don't know what happened. Let me see. I'll turn it over. I'm over here.
So anyway, Rukmini.
Rukmini and Krishna. So Krishna, he was very happy by our home. It was like a formal reception at the gateway first. He came in, Rukmini sent the kids forward. Seems in Vedic culture, even husband and wife wouldn't conquer anything in public, so, in the ancient times. Even this was still with his own work, with her own palace. But first she just sent the children in, and they came and hugged their father. Gave him garlands and things. Then she took him in the inner quarters and to give him her reception, her personal private reception. Her private reception. This is a restorative program, I say. And she bathed the feet of Krishna. She had the water and she bathed the feet with scented water, rose water, different waters, pusta, I call them. And she took Krishna's lotus feet and held that her over her heart. And she's looking at Krishna and she's so happy. At the same time, she's crying. So Krishna's like kind of uneasy, like you're seem happy but you're crying at the same time. Why are you crying when I come? There's like plenty of time for tears. And then he said, well, what's wrong? Is something wrong? I mean, it's like the kids were not listening to you this morning. Disobedient. The servant had an argument. He's there like speculating. Why are you crying on his arrival? And Rukmini just looking. She said, you don't know. You know everything. You know what Brahma is doing. Satya Loka. You know what Shiva is doing in Kailash. And he said, you don't know what your devotee feels for you in our hearts. It is the one thing you don't know. I know Radharani, she knows what I'm feeling now. But it seems you don't know.
I was like, it was a big thing for Krishna.
People don't tell him he doesn't know things.
So why do you want to be with me? I don't know. I can save him.
Sure, I mean, he was definitely a little fussy. He was pretty hard to fuss at Krishna, so that's why Rukmini is pretty special.
No, it's, tell me what's wrong. Why are you praying?
Is that wrong? I know that Radha knows. You came in Vrindavan, you captured everybody's heart in Vrindavan, and you left Vrindavan. Like that, you're coming here, you're capturing our heart. If you promise, you will never be in my promise. Not ever. But I cannot help but think that how, remember that although you come in here now, giving us your mercy, soon, your nature is your device.
and the world somewhere else.
No, no, I don't believe you. I do think they have.
She picked her up. I had that, and wiped the tears off. Maybe David finished. Just a simple reception, and mom breaks down crying, and she's doing. That was like, what made me special, because normally in union, we just feel happiness. And I felt so happy to see when I was the president in Guangzhou, we only had this little gentleman called I used to be the, at one point I was the president, the chief cook, head pujari, executive, counselor to all the people. I went to Vancouver and I had 4 lawyers in the temple that was right beside of the park in Montreal. So, holding out on the 3rd floor, I went to the building store. And so I would cook, we would get all kinds of bowl donated by the wholesale fruit terminus they have outside the city of wholesale fruit crates, where all the fruit comes in by trucks from America, from over here, Canada, and different ships. We would go there and they would fill up, they would give us, okay, take care for food relief and for the temple. Take a box of apples, a box of strawberries. There'd be hundreds of these merchants, and they go on, everybody would have a box. We'd fill up a whole little truck. And we'd have some, we were very poor in those days. I don't know how we were doing, but we had a bigger congregation. We didn't have a congregation, we didn't have books. So we didn't have so many. We didn't have many sources of income, so our main source of income was the Sunday feast. And we had all this boga. So I cooked a 26 preparation feast on a Sunday morning. We would have 6 chutneys, fruit chutneys. Because we had so many fruits growing, so we had fruit chutney, fruit halwa, 5 kinds of halwa, blueberry halwa, apple halwa, cherry halwa, whatever. It was just, didn't go into any preparation. I didn't chop meat and halwa. So I just went out and made pies and some cheese I could make. And the end of it was a huge. And it became very famous, and all the colleges from McGill, the beds right next to McGill, and all kinds of Indian community that came. We'd get 200-300 people for a Sunday feast. They would all contribute. We would request a $2 donation in those days. It was a long time ago. But that was $400, $500 we'd get. Most of the program was donated. With that, we would maintain the rent. Prepared this offering, I ran into the shower, came back up, because I was also head pujari, home pujari. And I take this big tray, after someone make the tray up, some other glories, and walk down the lawn to bowling alley, walk down the lawn, bowling alley, to bring that offering to Jagannath Balaji, the soup. That was one of the most happiest moments in my life. It was like a non-stop, 6-hour yaga, doing all that cooking. When I brought that offering, all these preparations of Jagannath. Still a place, very happy memory. So when I see Jagannath, you know, you're such a beautiful baby, so big, he's expanding. Very happy memories here. So like that. But when Krishna and Rukmini met, she was feeling happy that she was so special. She's also feeling separation, that I'm going to have to leave. He'll leave me, and miss him again. So it's very, she's very special. Meanwhile, while this is happening, Narayana flies to the window. And he's the guru of Krishna and Bharata, and that's his role. So Krishna's like, believe me, you know, it's getting pretty intense here. Wife's crying. So,
oh, Gurudev!
Jumps up, sir, Gurudev. Came out of this air with girlfriend in Krishna's mind, but he plays like this, plays the guy. What would he go for? Who knows? Who knows? But he came and Narada came and so Krishna went, gave him the Guru, he had a special seat there. Brought him in the Guru's seat. Now they made his feet together. But he saw that Narada was agitated. He said, like, what a day, you know, my Guru is always peaceful. He's always dear. And today the Guru is upset. My wife, I come at reception, she's crying. I'm like, what a day. What kind of day is it? It's not Lord of any day for Krishna. So yes, Narada Muni, you're always peaceful, you're always in control. Why are you disturbed today? I never seen you disturbed. Never, ever. You're a liberated soul. How can you be disturbed? And he said, well, I'm going around the world and I see the symptoms of Kali Yuga coming. I see the people are materialistic. They used to be simply attracted to you. Now they're becoming more attracted to sense gratification. And because of their attraction to the sense gratification, I'm ready, I can understand that you're about to leave. It's like when the sun is about to set, the same heat doesn't come on midday, even though midday is warm here, super warm, I guess there's 1 degree plus. But anyway, it's warmer midday, but at the end of the day, it's cooler. In India, they need 40. Not now, this is also winter for India. In Mayapur, midday, 25, 27, at this season. And at night time, we're down to a very cold 17, 15, something like that. But in Delhi, daytime was 5 midday, and the night was 1 degree, 2 degree. I cooled for Delhi when I was there for Delhi. So, Narada was using this example that the sun is setting. So therefore, the light is still there, but the influence is reduced. So you're still here, but you're just about to go. That's why your influence is reducing, and people becoming more materialistic. When you fully leave, what's going to happen? When you leave, the Kali Yuga begins. What's going to happen? I'm very worried. How are these people going to get delivered? How are the people in Kali Yuga going to get your mercy? So Narada Muni is so compassionate that although he's a liberated soul, he feels his compassion for the conditioned souls and how they can lead them free. So that's why I'm concerned, that's why I'm disturbed, because I see that you're about to leave and I don't see the hope for the conditioned souls. Tell them how they can get your mercy. So then Krishna, he said that today is a very special day for me. Today my wife is telling me that I don't know what my devotees feel for me. And my guru, he is very disturbed and he wants to know how the conditioned souls of Kali Yuga will get
liberated. Get the mercy.
So I promise you, I'll come back and come to you. But not as the Lord, I'll come back as the devotee. In order to, and I will deliver the conditioned souls, I'll give them the Harinama Sankirtan process to achieve bhakti. And as a devotee, I will experience what it is that my devotee feels.
Gauranga!
So Gauranga, if you know that, there is this mood of being a devotee.
The Lord, everything is possible. Okay, you don't know, you think, I don't know what it's like. When the body feels me, I'll become a devotee. You know, experience.
And when Lord Chaitanya experienced it, amazing, indescribable. Laughing in ecstasy, crying in ecstasy, rolling in the ground in ecstasy. Madness and separation of vision. Mahabhava. Just like Radharani would experience Mahabhava, he was experiencing Mahabhava. Lord Chaitanya, because he's Lord, but he's devotee. He has a more intimate relationship with the devotee. He can relate with the devotees very well. Devotee love, pure love. Krishna is different. We have to worship Krishna. Server and servant, served. That's it. Interesting. So I was thinking like that, John. Father's living in the cellar. Father can be a devotee. It's interesting. He becomes a devotee. He's no longer the father, but he's a devotee. It's a different mood. Krishna Chaitanya would sometimes flick back in his Ishwara bhava just for a few moments or something. Then it'll be different, then it's that he was the Lord, and the way to worship him. When he was a devotee, which was most of the time, then you couldn't worship him. You wouldn't accept the worship as God, because you said worship as a Vishnu. But not worship as God. So anyway.
Now we're just reading the second canto, which is about reciting the Lord's feet of the Lord. The first and second canto of the Lord's feet. The third canto is like the knee, or the fourth, the fifth canto, or the, I forget exactly how it works out, what is the waist, and you have the sixth and seventh is the chest, seventh, eighth, something like that, go up. Ninth is the neck, tenth is the face. Something like that, I may have one of them. The 11, 12, he came back over his feet, just like he was scratching it. So now we understand the greatness of the Lord, how he is so great, he creates, how he creates the universe, the universes, and how he creates them, he activates them, he does everything. The same, he creates this whole animation. Everything runs under the control of the different higher entities, under the laws of karma. Because I mean, there are people really upset in the tsunami sites. And some people told me, not one, one person said, where was God during the tsunami? It's all his fault. But there's no God. You know, just
people. They're bewildered, they don't know. Okay, why does God let these things happen? How does it allow them to be prepared? Of course, He doesn't want it. He doesn't want people to eat meat either. He doesn't want people to kill innocent other creatures. Unfortunately, there's a lot of majority of people are meat-eaters. And this is creating a lot of innocent animals who are being killed, horribly killed, mercilessly killed. And as a result, people also die. It's like a big karma comes back. Most of the people that were killed were hunters. But there were a lot of tourists. It is a horrible thing. We're trying to help people. We don't want to see people suffer. But that's why we're working so hard to prevent it. You see, things are going to happen. There's going to be wars. There's going to be tsunamis. There's going to be earthquakes. There's going to be cyclones and hurricanes and all kinds of things. As long as we break the laws of nature, and we create so many violent crimes against other living entities. And it's not, Krishna is watching. He's not like directly. He intervenes and saves devotees. He doesn't directly, it's not. He sends in the Bhagavad Gita very clearly that he sets up the system. And he has to prove it. Like, it comes in like for approval, but he doesn't direct his method. It all happens automatically. So, I mean, he's doing that with some kind of vendetta or anything. But sometimes, you know, like the vendetta, but that's like specifically if it's related, like people stealing property from the temple or something like that. In Sri Lanka, that's an interesting story. There was a fisherman, boat, a Muslim fisherman. They were out in the sea when the tsunami hit. And the tsunami was right under the boat. They didn't even know it. It was in the ocean. The tsunami was only very six, was it 15 centimeters or something? 50 centimeters. It's not a big thing. When it hits the shore, it's right. So he was out fishing, and then when it was hidden, his village was being destroyed. He didn't know. But then he saw this picture, this not picture, but he saw it actually in the ocean, like the vision of an antecession, a big snake with a blue person lying down on the snake. And he was a Muslim, he didn't know who this was. He just was surprised at how can somebody be lying on a snake and how are they in the middle of the ocean? So he freaked him out. So they went back to his village. When he came back, you know, there was nothing there, but everything was completely destroyed by the tsunami. He missed the whole thing. And then he told them that somehow he was able to go and save his baby boy, and this and that, was stuck on a tree, or you know, something. Detailed thing. He just reached there in time to help people. And afterwards he told them he saw this vision, or he saw this person in the ocean, how is it possible? And some person said, well, I know that. That sounds like a Hindu god that's a temple down the road, something like that. I went back one time to the window of the world. And so they went and he saw that there was this manifestation deity 2 kilometers down the way. They put it in the newspaper because it was a Muslim that saw it. I thought it was, but they couldn't be lying. They didn't even know these things. But the Hindu had said it. But all the major papers that came out of the moment, something like that. So Krishna was there and helped him get back and save his family. I don't know exactly what it means. This kind of third hand story for the newspaper. Krishna protects his devotees. Name Bhakta Pranashati Somebody surrenders to Krishna, he takes the personal care for that person. But if somebody's not very personally taking any kind of service attitude to the Lord, then he doesn't necessarily take a personal care. Also, the Lord gives a warning like this. Tsunami has a warning. When it comes in, it sucks all of it. It stays out from the shore. I saw pictures of it. It was out several kilometers from the shore of the white wave. And it like sucks in all the water from the shore, and then it builds up, builds up, builds up. So what happens is that the beach goes back for kilometers dry. But the tourists, people didn't know this. All tsunami did for so many years. They didn't really forget. They thought, wow, look at far out, the beach is so big, they're running further out, not knowing that they have a 10-minute warning. In 10 minutes, a huge wave should be coming. They should be running as fast as they can the other way. There was a little girl who, in her geology class, she brought this, that tsunamis suck out the water from the beach, told, Mommy, Mommy, this is a sign of tsunami. And she got all the people from the beach and they ran away, and that particular beach, 200 people were saved. There was another old lady whose grandfather told her that when the water goes far out, it's going to come back big, in a big wave. So she told her villagers, let's go, this is a big wave coming, big wave coming. They all ran around for stuff, and they went up to a temple and took shelter up in a Buddhist temple in Thailand, and they were saved. So people have 10-minute warnings. A lot of people, they just ran out further out when they came in. And Krishna gives us warnings, different ways. Prabhupada said, being God is a very tough job. Like the thieves are praying, I'm starving, I have no way to bring in my family. Please allow me to steal from this householder and feed my family, buy my drugs, whatever they bring. And the householder is praying, please protect me from the thieves. I don't want to be robbed. So who does Krishna listen to? Both they're praying one way or another. So usually he gives some kind of warning to the householder. The thief would come, some warning is there, but if they're not careful, and they don't take the warning seriously, and the thief gets a chance. Just like mosquito praying, I have to have the blood to drink. And the people praying, please don't let the mosquito bite me, because I don't want to get malaria or sick or anything. So the mosquito first goes by and hear, so I'm here. I said, why are they also by the ear? It's like, this is warning. Take care. Mosquitoes are here. So like when we did some of the things, so this is a tiger has a little rotor like a guinea pig. And whenever the tiger is about to strike this little rodent type animal, it's too small for the tiger to catch. It goes in some hole and some. Just when the tiger is about to leave, they can leave in huge distances. This animal goes up, makes some sound. Then that animal is only the tigers. Tiger doesn't like that. But he can't do nothing about it. It's like that's a special warning given by Krishna to the deers. Otherwise the deers don't stand a chance. But if the deer say, is that really a tiger? It's crazy. No. When you hear that sound, you go. You say, you hesitate 1 minute, the tiger's already in the air. 1 second. So people need to know how Krishna creates the universe, how Krishna operates. Then they won't put the blame on Krishna. Why there's a tsunami, why there's a hurricane, why there's a car accident. These things are being done by very mechanical laws of nature, which are being directed by personalities like Yamaraj. And He didn't ask Yamaraj, why me? Like there was a time when this one sage, he was arrested because he was falsely accused of something, he was arrested. He was sentenced by the judge to be killed by a firing squad of spears. And then the king found out, and he sent a messenger to stop him because he knew the sage was innocent. But the sage was tied to the post. All the soldiers of Yamar get set, and they're just about to fire the spears at him. And I was like, talk about tension, right? You just have a firing squad. Ready to go, and the messenger comes up, order from the king, save the rishi. So the king said, why, you know, when he had so much power, he could go to Yamaraj and ask him, why did this happen to me? What did I do to deserve it? I didn't do nothing to anybody, I'm a vegetarian, I didn't hurt anybody. Why did I get this violent kind of danger? I mean, this was. And he said, when you were a 4-year-old child, you took a grass straw, and there was a little insect. You were poking the insect. The insect was feeling it. For him, the straw was like a gigantic spear coming down, and it was practically going to punch his eyes out. And he was fearful like anything that you're putting him in so much danger. So as a reaction to that karma, you had to be put on the firing squad and feel that fear. I was a 4-year-old, 3-year-old, and come on, what do I didn't know anything. He said, this is completely unreasonable that as a little child I did something out of my stupidity and I had to take the full reaction. I curse you to become a suitor. This is a stupid, you know. You're a karmic wild, stupid, you know, shouldn't be like that. Then he made a curse, he said, I have two curses. One is that from now on, all the parents, up till the child is 5 years of age, they have to take all their karma for whatever their children do. So parents, beware, the kids are poking little insects, or pulling heads off of mice or something, you know, you're in big trouble. You don't see, they don't do anything violent. So, but then that's how Yamaraj became Vidura, because he was cursed by the sage. I think people, they really, we can understand, they really need, if they could know Vedic culture, they'd know a lot more how the laws of karma work, and they would not be so resentful to Krishna. We bring it on ourselves. So anyway, thank you all very much for your patience. And today we're having initiation ceremony right after this, after your breakfast. After you interview the candidates. Now we can start. Did the group from Toronto ever show up? Did we find out about them? Did they draw?
Yeah, they got part of the paper. This is supposed to be a lot.
Did they have an accident? Any questions anybody has? Yes, what's your name?
Chantalini.
This question about chanting japa. I've heard many things, either not think about anything, just try to listen, hear the Mahamantra, or meditate when you're chanting japa, meditate on the activities form of Krishna, and also when we're chanting, we should chant with separation. Letter from the long lost lover, because I don't know which of these three I'm supposed to do, or all, or know what should I not think about anything and just listen? Should I be thinking about it?
Interesting question. Good question, actually.
Yeah, the only time this question was asked Srila Prabhupada, maybe not so graphically, but he asked what they should do. He said they should chant and hear. The main thing is to chant and hear the mantra. While hearing the mantra, we want that by getting purified that we will naturally feel separation from Krishna. If we're thinking about our boyfriend, or the old letter, and we're trying to, that becomes like sahaja. We're trying to take the material emotion, we're trying to feel that while we chant like Krishna. But it becomes more like a drama. We want to feel that for Krishna. We want that emotion for Krishna to awaken in our heart. And if we do it artificially, then we will feel those emotions, but it will not be the spiritual, fully satisfying emotion that we want. There are people in India that specialize in this kind of chanting with very so much emotion, but it's not that something that actually spontaneously happens. It's something that they impose, like that they're trying to think of something that normally would make them feel like that and chant. That becomes a bit artificial. That's what it's called the sahaja, making the whole thing cheap. We want to chant, we want to hear, and we want to feel those emotions from Krishna, naturally. But what you said about thinking about the pastimes, that's something that happens naturally while we're chanting. Sometimes just the remembrance of the pastime comes in the mind. That's okay. What I've understood is that it's alright if the pastime naturally comes in our mind. When we're thinking of the pastime while we're chanting, that's auspicious, there's nothing wrong with it. We try to think of the pastime while we're chanting, then we don't listen to the chanting. The chanting is Krishna. The holy name is Krishna. So we want to meditate on Krishna. And while we're meditating on Krishna, then he reveals to us his rupa, his guna, his lila. These things start to manifest in the mind. If it comes naturally while we're chanting and we start thinking of some pastime of Krishna without like having to really work at it as a separate kind of exercise, or listening to the mantra or trying to remember 4th chapter, 17 verse, it should come just naturally that while we're chanting and remember Krishna. That's okay. This is what I understood as the
When you were telling us this story about Krishna and what experience with his wife and Narada when he was there, it made me think what actually the devotee did. So now I am asking the question, what about us who are hearing this and having desire to be the devotee? and in Lord Chaitanya pastimes, in this when Lord Chaitanya manifested himself to devotees, his devotees, in that form they worship, they meditate. And when he manifested to Namacharya, Haridas Thakur, he went out of consciousness. And Lord Chaitanya said, get up, I'm here. So now the comment was that when devotees are internal and experiencing internal this intense feeling, they are not functional external. They are not aware what's happening. And one of the Swamis, when he was perceiving, watching what's happening in the spiritual world, and one sage was passing by and he was laughing and he thought he's laughing to him. It means he was not aware. So, what is for us chance? You said we should not meditate on it for our relationship in that time. You said here. And if Krishna manifested in mind to us, it's just in mind. Because we are still.
I think she misunderstood what I said. If you're chanting, and Krishna manifests in the mind, it's okay.
And, but we are still functional. We are serving externally.
No.
Is this enough, only having
in mind? It's like when the devotees, we all came from Montreal and Toronto. We went in 1969 to receive Prabhupada when he was arriving in Boston. And at that time, the devotees were so much for the separation to see Prabhupada. Because he went from here, and we didn't know if he was coming back. He was ill. He was going to India for Ayurvedic treatment. He was having some heart problems. So we were like very praying and that's when namaste and everything. And then, so Prabhupada came back and the devotees came from the whole eastern United States that track. We were in the new temple in Boston and they came out from New York. And we only had a few temples in the east. That was in Montreal and Toronto. So that time we all came and met in Boston. So in the airport there was about 150 devotees. And then when the devotees, Prabhupada was under some kind of ventilation, so there was like a screen, one of those portable, movable screens, so you could see the feet, and you could see, you know, it was just like 6 feet high. So Prabhupada raised his feet bag above the top of the screen, so then the devotees saw, they just went like, wow, they're jumping up and down, and somehow devotee, Prabhupada took his hand and he hit another devotee on the head with his cartons. And that devotee, we don't know how, somebody maybe hit himself, we don't know, but somehow the devotee was cut. But they were like so much ecstatic that Prabhupada was there. They're jumping up and down. One newspaper guy was out photographing blood pouring down his head. He was smiling and Prabhupada, and he's bleeding, you know. So that he, you know, that was like, okay, these people are really not conscious of their bodies because he's bleeding, you know, he's hurt. And he's smiling, and see his expression was like, I need all of help, I don't know. And he doesn't even know that he's bleeding until maybe got in his eye or something.
So it means the devotees are expressing love for him.
That means that when you're in that ecstasy for that moment, you're not aware of what's going on in your body. But 90%, we're very much aware of what's going on in our body. But sometimes when we are in that ecstasy, we're not really not so much aware. That time, Krishna has to take over the external running of our bodies. If you happen to go into that extreme pain of bhava ecstasy, where you're not, that time, that will override your material sense perception, and you'll be more aware, suddenly be aware of what's happening in the moment that you cut your leg or you do something, and you are that time in ecstasy. So, this work with pain is just that our body is like an instrument panel, like in the car. It tells you, problem, beep, beep, beep. You know, look at your leg, you have some problem. Some insect is biting you or something. That's how we are. What pain means is we're being informed. We're not the body, but we're getting this pain and pleasure, thinking that this is a real experience, but the actual experience is a spiritual bliss. And that bliss isn't dependent on the body. When you're feeling that spiritual heaven, you're chanting Hare Krishna and feeling ecstasy, your mind is a spectator. The mind is beyond the mind, it's beyond the senses. It's watching, it doesn't even know where this happiness is coming from.
We can trace out if I have a good sandesh or if I eat an opiate that maybe this is giving some heaven. I was feeling more happiness taking that plate of offering to Jagannath than later eating the prasad, although it was also nice. But offering it was so much ecstasy to take that after that yajna. We had all the devotees there in the temple cooking, that was a whole service. Taking it to Jagannath, I was so ecstatic, I can't have words to express how much happiness I felt at doing that simple cooking yajna and offering to Jagannath. So you get these happinesses, but they're not dependent on the, they're completely out of this world.
So devotee is expressing love by insults, or love for guru by pleasing him, trying to...
Yeah, it says that when we're in the material world, when we're still identifying with our bodies, we express our love for Krishna through seva, through service. And when we're liberated, and we get out into the nitya lila, that time we'll realize our eternal relationship with Krishna. And that time we'll express our love for Krishna through that relationship, as a cowherd friend, as a parent, as a lover, as a wife, as a whatever our relationship, as a servant, whatever the relationship is. That's how we express it when we're in the lilas. That kind of darkness, like Mother Yasoda is not chanting japa, but she's chanting Krishna's name all the time, and she loves Krishna like a mother. And it's a natural thing. Does it make sense now? Do you understand?
Yes.
But through that seva, you can actually experience the spiritual taste, spiritual ecstasy.
And when devotee is greedy for service, greedy, it means that there is...
You get some devotees to say, why? And in fact, some devotees eagerly get service, so that all the time, everybody is putting a lot of service. Lord is ready to hear the service up to, you have two up to your capacity, you have to finish your rounds, you have to do all the service. But, that's really good. You should be ready here to do service. You find some devotees, they're ready here to do service. Then you find some devotees who have a certain amount of eagerness, maybe not so much sure, and then, but then they wonder why. I'm doing all the service, everyone gives it to me, nobody else, but I'm doing it to them. I get into some kind of resentment. And that's unfortunate because we should be so greedy to do the service that we don't let anybody else do the service. We should try to facilitate others to do service too, but we should be very eager to do service. That's how we benefit. Those who are more eager, those who have more desire to serve, generally they are the ones who move up faster in spiritual life. We made it! We're all learning!
We're going
to fall out.
Huh? Fall out! We're going to do a little.
Oh. Everybody's safe.
I feel that we missed Adama.
We missed?
Adama is a different guy.
Oh, Jami.
How many bands came?
Two bands. And then, how many bands?
How many are with Ajahn? Who is this? Peter. So we don't have too far connection. I have some oil from the Shikade offering in my airport. I think I have it,
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.